Welcome back, everyone. My name is Edwin, also known as SOLIDSNAKEee, and today we are once again playing Mass Effect 1, trying to do that Paragon playthrough. One quick thing I want to get out of the way. I've had a few personal things come up lately, which is why I haven't uploaded much recently. I have decided that instead of wasting my life trying to wait for a few things to work themselves out, I am instead going to get back to recording. So, just gives me something to do, and entertain you guys. As of recording this, Halo Wars 2 is going through its second beta, the Blitz beta. If you guys would like to see some gameplay of that, be sure to let me know in the comments down below. Aside from that, ladies and gents, let's get back into it. Talk to Joker.
Commander, something you need?
Ship status.
How's the Normandy performing? Is she everything they said she'd be?
She's the best ship in the fleet, if you've got a pilot who knows how to handle her. Balance isn't what you'd expect. Takes a while to get used to that oversized drive core we got stuffed in the back, and her power can sneak up on you if you're not careful. The Normandy's probably too much ship for your average Alliance pilot, Commander. Lucky for you, I'm anything but average.
So you're like a special average. Above average. Yeah, we'll go with that. Above average. I just want
to
talk.
I'd like to know my crew. Mind if I ask you a few questions?
I can see where this is going. You did a background check on me, didn't you? Well, I'll tell you the same thing I told the captain. You want me as your pilot. I'm not good. I'm not even great. I am the best damn helmsman in the Alliance fleet. Top of my class in flight school, I earned that. All those commendations in my file, I earned every single one. Those weren't given to me as charity for my disease.
I wasn't trying to offend you, Joker.
I'm sorry, Joker. I didn't even know you were sick.
You mean you didn't know?
Nope.
Oh, crap.
Yep.
Okay, I've got Vrolik syndrome, brittle bone disease. The bones in my legs never develop properly. They're basically hollow, too much force, and they'll shatter. Even with crutches and my leg braces, it's hard to get around. One wrong step and crack! It's very dramatic. But I've learned to manage my condition, Commander. Put the Normandy in my hands and I'll make her dance for you. Just don't ask me to get up and dance unless, you know, you like the sound of snapping shin bones.
Yeah. Snap, crackle, and pop. How'd you get your nickname?
Why does everyone call you Joker?
It's a lot shorter than saying Alliance Flight Lieutenant Jeff Moreau. Plus, I love to make little children laugh.
I was just thinking how much you remind me of Santa Claus.
Look, I didn't pick the name. One of the instructors in flight school used to bug me about never smiling. She started calling me Joker, and it stuck.
You're unhappy?
Why didn't you ever smile?
Hey, I worked my ass off in flight school, Commander. The world's not going to hand you anything if you go around grinning like an idiot.
Not with that attitude.
By the end of the year, I was the best pilot in the academy. Even better than the instructors, and everybody knew it. They'd all got their asses kicked by the sickly kid with the creaky little legs. One guess who was smiling at graduation.
Tell me about your disease.
I need to know more about this Vrolik syndrome if I'm putting my ship in your hands.
Yeah, of course you do. It's an extremely rare condition. Nobody knows exactly what causes it. Genetic, maybe. It's treatable, but there's no cure. Classify my case as moderate to severe. I was born with over a dozen fractures, hip, thighs, ankles, my bones were already breaking in the womb. 100 years ago, I wouldn't have survived past my first year. Lucky for me, modern medical science has turned me into a productive member of society.
How do you do your job?
You're not going to break a bone trying to fly the ship, are you?
I don't fly with my feet, Commander, so I'm fine as long as I'm in this chair. I gotta be real careful when I get up to take a piss, though. I can do my job as well as anyone on the ship. Better, actually. So don't worry about it.
So sassy. Let's change topics.
I'm not trying to make you uncomfortable. Let's talk about something else.
Whatever you want, Commander.
Yep. That's it.
I have to go.
Alright, see you.
Hasta la pasta, Joker. Let's go talk to Presley. The spacist. Space racist.
If anyone has to take over for Captain Anderson, I'm glad it's you. I'm not sure about having non-humans on our ship, though.
They're on our side.
We're all on the same team here, Presley.
With all due respect, sir, that's what they said about Nihlus. Look how that turned out.
Nihlus didn't talk shit about anybody. He got shot in the back of the head. Execution style. Aliens on the ship.
Speak freely, Presley. I want to know if you have a problem with non-humans.
It's not that, Commander. Humanity has always handled its own problems. Saren attacked one of our colonies. We should be the ones to stop him. We don't need their help.
Never turn away help. It's rude, for one.
Some people think asking for help is a sign of weakness. That's just being stupid and stubborn. No matter how strong you are, allies can make you stronger.
I guess so. Maybe I'm just stuck in the old ways of thinking. But don't worry, Commander. This won't be a problem.
Ah, you're just an old fart. And a racist. That's not a compliment.
Personal How did you questions? End up assigned to the Normandy?
I signed up with the Alliance as a navigator right out of school, following in my grandfather's footsteps, I guess. My first posting was on the Agincourt. We were one of the first reinforcements to arrive at Elysium after the Blitz hit. Those raiders were no match for an Alliance frigate. Of course, the only reason the colony was still standing was because of you, Commander. I can't believe you held out as long as you did.
I guess you could say I'm a pretty big badass. But now you're here.
How'd you end up on the Normandy?
I got my officer's commission after Elysium. Must have made an impression on the right people. Captain asked for me when he was picking his crew.
It's pretty dope, dude. Okay.
Carry on,
let's
Presley.
Get back to it.
Yes, sir.
Paragon. Okay, I need to go talk to the people in the bottom hangar. Go talk to Caden. He's over here. Just chilling by the water cooler. It's not a water cooler. We're gonna put a water cooler there. It's gonna be dope. Not really, but really. That awkward stare, though.
Anything you need, Commander?
Looking for personal input.
Just trying to get a sense of where the crew's at. Thoughts?
I've wasted enough of your time for now, Commander. We'll have time for personal debriefings later.
Tactical appraisal?
What's your opinion on the last mission?
I don't see how we could have done things any better. At least not without getting to Eden Prime sooner. And we were on the scene faster than any other Alliance ship could have been.
Yeah. Well, as
we'll
you
talk
were.
Another time, Lieutenant.
Swiggity swiggity. Sleeper pod. There's nobody in these. That's a terrible waste of power. Anybody here? Nah. Okay. Invisible loading screen! I am actually thinking about, reducing the amount of time that I record these episodes for. So instead of it being like 2 or 3 hours per episode, I'll probably cut it down, record for an hour and then cut it down as necessary. So if things take me like half an hour or whatever, you'll get a half an hour episode, even if it takes me an hour to get said footage. That's just to cut out all the boring crap, because nobody wants to watch that boring crap. Garrus, Vicarian, how you doing,
Thanks
buddy?
For bringing me on board, Commander.
No problem.
I knew working with a Spectre would be better than life at CSAC.
You know.
Have you worked with a Spectre before?
Well, no, but I know what they're like. Spectres make their own rules. You're free to handle things your way. At CSAC, you're buried by rules. The damn bureaucrats are always on your back.
It's not that bad.
For the most part, the rules are there for a reason.
Maybe. But sometimes it feels like the rules are only there to stop me from doing my work. If I'm trying to take down a suspect, it shouldn't matter how I do it, as long as I do it.
Wrong.
But CSEC wants it done their way. Protocol and procedure come first. That's why I left.
Well, they're there for a reason. Because, you know, what is it? Due processing, I believe it's called. That was your reason?
So you just quit because you didn't like the way they do things?
There's more to it than that. It didn't start out bad, but as I rose in ranks, I got saddled with more and more red tape. C6 handling of Saren was typical. I just couldn't take it anymore. I hate leaving.
It's a tough decision, but you're doing the right thing.
I hope you made the right choice. I'd hate for you to regret it later.
Well, that's sort of why I teamed up with you. It's a chance for me to get off the Citadel, see how things are done outside C6. Either way, I plan to make the most of this.
Damn straight.
Without C6 headquarters looking over my shoulder, well, maybe I can get the job done my way for a change.
Well, that depends.
If getting the job done means endangering innocent people, then no. We get the job done right, not fast. Got it?
I wasn't trying to. I understand, Commander.
I feel like such a dick, but you gotta do what you gotta do. Can't have people fucking up. Ashley.
Commander?
How we doing?
What's your opinion on the last mission?
Kinda wish you'd got there sooner, Commander. No offense, I appreciate the rescue. I just wish...
That we saved your squad?
You wish we'd been able to save the rest of your unit?
Yes, sir. If I had been more alert, we wouldn't have been cut down by an ambush.
Don't blame yourself.
The Geth are perfect ambushers. They don't move, they don't make noise, they don't even breathe.
Sir, they have flashlight heads. I'll make sure it doesn't happen again.
The look she gives you is just... it's comical.
Do you have a few minutes to talk one-on-one?
I'm sorry, Commander. I need to get my duty squared away. I wouldn't mind talking more later, though.
Rightio then, Ashley.
Dismissed, Chief.
Sir.
I'm not romancing her. It's not gonna happen. I'm gonna make a quick save. Just in case we bugger things up. Rex!
Nice ship you've got, Shepard.
Well, thank
you. What can I do for you?
Personal inquiry.
What's your story, Rex?
There's no story.
There's always a story.
Go ask the Quarian if you want stories.
Come on.
You Krogan lived for centuries. Don't tell me you haven't had a few interesting adventures.
Well, there was this one time the Turians almost wiped out our entire race. That was fun.
That's unfortunate, buddy.
I heard about that. You know, they almost did the same to us.
It's not the same.
It isn't?
It seems pretty much the same to me.
So your people were infected with a genetic mutation? An infection that makes only a few in a thousand children survive birth? And I suppose it's destroying your entire species?
I see your point. I can understand why you're annoyed.
I suppose it isn't all the same.
I don't expect you to understand, but don't compare humanity's fate with the Krogan.
Touchy subject?
I was just making conversation. I wasn't trying to upset you.
Your ignorance doesn't upset me, Shepard. As for the Krogan, I gave up on them long ago.
But Rex...
The genophage infected us, but it's not what's killing us.
You're killing each other.
Are your people really dying?
We're sure not getting any stronger. We're too spread out. None of us are interested in staying in our own system.
Isn't that hypocrisy, though?
Lots of species have left their homes and prospered.
But they go to colonize new worlds. We're not settlers. We're warriors. We want to fight. So we leave. Hire ourselves out. And most of us never go back.
The warriors what? Live by the sword, die by the sword. The genophage.
What can you tell me about the genophage?
Ask the Solarians if you want details. They made it. All I know, it makes breeding nearly impossible. Thousands die in stillbirth, and most never get that far. Every Krogan is infected, everyone. And no one's rushing to find a cure.
It's fucked up.
Why don't the Krogan try to find a cure?
When was the last time you saw a Krogan scientist? You ask a Krogan, would he rather find a cure for the genophage or fight for credits? He'll choose fighting every time. It's just
that's stupid and ignorant,
Shepard. I can't change that. Nobody can.
Actually, yeah, you could if you sit down long enough.
So long, Rex.
Shepard.
Pretty brutal. Tally. Anything down here for me to inspect? Engineer Adams.
Hey, Commander, you know that Quarian Tally? She's been spending all her time down here asking me about our engines.
Is she bothering you?
I'll tell her to leave you alone.
What? No, she's amazing. I wish my guys were half as smart as she is. Give her a month on board and she'll know more about our engines than I do. She's got a real knack for technology, that one. I can see why you wanted her to come along.
She is useful, and pretty lovable.
I figured she'd be a real asset to the team.
You got an eye for talent, Commander, but I'm guessing that's not why you came down here.
No. What's a stealth system
where
like?
Else have you served, Adams?
If you name a class of Alliance ship, I've probably served on it. Everything from dreadnoughts and carriers right down to frigates like the Normandy. My last assignment was on the Tokyo, only a cruiser, but she was a good ship. Couldn't hold a candle to the Normandy, though.
Stealth system.
Fill me in on the IES stealth systems. How does it work exactly?
You can't hide a ship out in space. They emit too much heat and radiation. Too easy for sensors to pick them up. Unless you find a way to capture those emissions. So our stealth systems trap the energy we give off in storage sinks built into the ship itself. No emissions to give away our location. Eventually the sinks have to be vented. More than a few hours silent running and they overheat. Cook us inside our own hull.
So we're invisible?
There's no way for anyone to detect us?
To radar?
A visual scan can still pick us up. Anyone looking out a window can see us plain as day. But you have to be pretty close to get an actual visual out in space. Most vessels rely on scanners. As long as the stealth systems are engaged, they can't see us. Not unless we accelerate to FTL speeds.
FTL gives us away?
Why doesn't it work with faster than light travel?
Cranking up the FTL blue shifts our emissions, pushes them into frequencies too high to capture in the sinks. As soon as we make the jump, it's like setting off a flare. Sensors can pick up our location whenever we enter or exit FTL flight, but for short-range missions, our stealth systems are amazing, and we've got the only one.
Awesome. What about the Normandy?
I want to know more about the Normandy.
She's the best ship I've ever served on. Probably the fastest vessel ever designed. And she's the only one using the new Tantalus drive core.
The drive core?
What's so special about the Tantalus drive core?
Proportionally, it's about twice the size of any other vessel. Not only are we faster, but we can run at FTL speeds longer before we have to discharge the core.
Hmm. Okay.
Carry on, Adams.
Aye, aye, Commander.
Rightio. Believe we've talked to everybody. Let's talk to the requisition officer. See if he's got anything.
Looking
for
supplies?
Let's see what you've got.
You bet, Commander.
Ah, right. The super expensive things. Pistol. Power soon. Still got one of the best ones. Rightio. Well, let's go do a mission. And then head back to the Citadel, because I'm pretty sure people are going to be wanting to talk to us. Weirdos. I'm not sure if I mentioned it or not already, but if we are on a planet, and it's taken me quite a while to complete that, like, one mission, there's like 60-something quests in the game. So if it's taken me a while to complete that, I'm probably just going to cut out all of the traveling and stuff in the Mako, because that shit takes a long ass time. And mostly it's just driving from point A to point B. It's quite tedious, to be perfectly honest. But I will try to get like one or two episodes out every day or so. Citadel. You guys can read through all of that if you want. Pause the screen, read through all of that text. I did not mean to do that, but I am a big dummy. Remember whenever I was watching one of the playthroughs forever ago, that nebula. I was really looking to like read through all of the text, and the guy just wouldn't like pause the screen for me to read it. It's quite annoying. Navaria, astrophysical station, Pharos. We're gonna do that at some point. That's a DLC. Kepler Verge. Let's do that. Newton. No, actually, no. Let's bugger. Keep thinking if you spam B, you'll go back to the system. No, we were going to do something in a terminus system. Hades Gamma, I remember that being a thing. Gamma Verge. Okay, so Hades Gamma, we'll do that first. Athena. Yeah, okay, we'll go here. She looks so dope. Mass Effect 3 really does a lot to try to mitigate the issues that you have with Mass Effect 1. Does a hell of a better job. Let's see. Go with the first planet right here. Okay, nothing here. How many planets we got out here? Oh, that's at the edge. Well, we'll go from ring to ring. Adamos. Survey the crap out of it. Large concentration of hydrogen. Ploba. It's a belief Ploba is a Jupiter brain. Planet size supercomputer. Parents of this theory have fearlessly beamed signals towards sunken megastructures, hoping to get the machine's attention. Interesting stuff. Matriarch's writings discovered. You've recovered a strange object orbiting Ploba. Chief Engineer Adams and Tally tried unsuccessfully to determine its origin. They did find one of the matriarchs. Delinagas writings stored within. So that's one of the quests where you have to find a bunch of those, and it's a total pain in the ass, and you get like no reward for it. Treatment. We'll come back to that. Anything out here? Vimal. Scan that for element survey. It scans from orbit detect. Large deposit of uranium. And we'll go over here. Nada. Okay. Go for that real quick. Not so quick to make it impossible for anybody looking to read it. Radio, let's land. Okay, let's take Rex and Caden. The Mako. Hello, darkness, my old friend. Game clues. Okay, so that's. Let's jump. Was there a way to fire the main gun? No, not like an exit. Okay, it's RB. So, one thing I'm not ashamed to admit. Is that I need to scan a bunch of the areas. So right here you're gonna see like just all of this stuff. There's actually a thing right here and another object up around here. I'm not ashamed to go out my way and look up a map for these areas, these planets, because there's a bunch of them and they take a hell of a lot of time. So for most of the exploration in the game, you're gonna see me do that. What we got right here? Ancient debris. As any smart man would do, I've got a save right here. Make a new save. Never hurts to make a new save. Recover the object. What do we get? Terrain insignia. No signs of any survivors. The pod is empty except for a small tattered flag marked with the Nemines colony insignia. That's pretty dope. Okay, where else do we need to go? Mark it on the map. Really wish you could use the map a little bit more easily. That's a whole lot of fuck that. Yeah. Oh. Buggers. Pressure Maws. I forgot how much I hate these things. I forgot I hit these things. Oh, I got over here.
Kill them all.
Yeah, there we go. That's what I like. Just drive around, fire on the main gun. My gun is not actually getting an angle. Damn it. There we go.
Where is everybody?
Okay.
I'm on my way.
What a fantastic question. So let us save. So many saves. So little time.
According to these data logs, the survey Computer team console. Unearthed some kind of alien technology.
Could be answers at the excavation site.
Rightio, chaps. Let us get our butts in here. Nothing bad could possibly happen. Right? No, I said happen. Happen. Let's get our asses in there. I think I remember this. I believe there's a bomb in here. In fact, I'm almost certain there's a bomb in here. Reaper stuff. Okay, well, overload's gonna be insurmountable right here. Barrier, you can use that. I think we'll all use barrier. Oh, we level up. Come on, gun. Cool down. Who the hell is using a sniper rifle? I have warp, don't I? We'll use throw as well. I think I want to level up, bro. Just for the effects that we'll have in computer games. Okay, we still have one more over here.
I've heard of this. Machine cultists. They unearth some kind of alien technology, and it turns them into mindless fanatics.
Whatever they found, it's long gone now.
It's a dragon's tooth. Probably locked until I walk towards it. They're both locked. Make a quick save. It's not. Oh my god! Okay, you can use overload. You can use that. I will also use that. Oh, bugger. I can't move. I'm stuck in something. You can go for a little ride. The contents of all the ExoGeni survey team converted to cybernetic husks by devices similar to those used by the Gav Need Prime. How they came to be buried on a frontier world so far from Gav territory is a mystery. Alrighty. I don't believe there's any new dialogue. I mean, we can look, but I don't think there is. If Caden does not have any new dialogue. We didn't speak to Tally. That's what we didn't do. We still need to do that. We will do that. Get her little dialogue out of the way. Caden. My boy. Awkward silence. Awkward stare.
Anything you need, Commander?
Looking for personal input.
Just trying to get a sense of where the crew's at. Thoughts?
I've wasted enough of your time for now, Commander. We'll have time for personal debriefings.
What's your opinion on the last mission?
I don't see how. And we were on the same path, Commander.
Let's talk to Tally.
Your ship's amazing, Shepard. I've never seen a drive core like this before. I can't believe you were able to fit it into a ship this small. I'm starting to understand why you humans have been so successful. I had no idea Alliance vessels were so advanced.
See, you can fit big things in small places, Tally. That's another thing that humans are special for. This ship's special. Normally, they're not. Gathering information on us?
The Normandy's a prototype. Cutting-edge technology.
A month ago, I was patching a makeshift fuel line into a converted tug ship in the flotilla. Now, I'm sitting on board one of the most advanced vessels in Citadel space.
The most advanced.
I have to thank you again for bringing me along. Traveling on a vessel like this is a dream come true for me.
You're into ships?
I had no idea you found ship technology so interesting.
It comes with being a Quarian. The migrant fleet is the key to the survival of my people. Ships are our most valuable resource. But we don't have anything like this. We make do with cast-offs and second-hand equipment. We just try to keep them running for as long as we can. Some of the fleet's larger vessels date all the way back to our original flight from the Geth.
Bloody Nora. One thing that just bothered me there, I just noticed it, is you cannot hear her breathing in her with her filter. It's just simple thing I noticed. That was 300 years ago.
I can't believe your fleet's still using ships that are 3 centuries old.
They're constantly being repaired, modified, and refitted. They aren't pretty, but they work, mostly. We've tried to make ourselves as independent as possible on the flotilla. Grow our own food, mine, and process our own fuel. But some things we just can't make on our own. A patch to maintain the hull integrity requires raw materials we just don't have. That's why our pilgrimages are so important.
To find planets. Okay. Get the resources for Quarians.
Tell me about your people.
Our lives aren't easy. Resources are scarce, and we are constantly on the move. Everything we do must in some way contribute to the continuation of the migrant fleet. There are 17 million Quarians in the flotilla, and each of us relies on the others for survival. The bonds among my people are strong. Unfortunately, we have had to surrender many of the freedoms and civil liberties other species take for granted.
Such as?
What kind of freedoms?
Well, it's illegal for parents to have more than one child. If our population grows too much, it would strain our resources to their breaking point. Of course, we also can't allow our numbers to become too few. If our population is in decline, the rule against single births is temporarily repealed.
Hmm.
In extreme cases of population decline, incentives are even offered to encourage multiple births. Though the Conclave hasn't had to take such measures in nearly a century.
The Conclave?
That's your government.
The Conclave is our civilian branch of government. Each ship can elect a representative to serve on the Conclave and make decisions that affect the fleet as a whole. On matters that affect an individual ship, however, the captain has the final say. It's a tradition that dates back to the early days, when the fleet was governed by martial law. Fortunately, most captains nowadays are smart enough to have an elected council from their crew to give them advice and guidance.
You're democratic? That makes sense.
So the ultimate power rests with elected officials.
In practice, the Conclave and the respective council for each ship tend to set the rules that govern our daily lives. But in theory, we are still under military jurisdiction. The 5 top-ranking military officials in the fleet serve on the Admiralty Board. These 5 have the power to overrule any decision by the Conclave in case of emergency. To do so requires unanimous agreement among the Admiralty, and they can only do this once. After that, the entire board must resign their posts. It's a safeguard that served us well. In nearly 3 centuries, the Admiralty Board has only overruled the Conclave 4 times.
That's pretty dope, I'm not gonna lie. So you got like a brick glass in case of emergency, but you can only do it once. Geth.
I want to know more about the Geth.
I doubt I can tell you anything you don't already know. It's been almost 3 centuries since they drove my people into exile. All I know is the story of their origins. What they were when we created them, and how they turned on us.
Tell me.
Interesting.
The Geth were originally created to serve as an automated manual labor force. Initially, their intelligence was as limited as any VI. Over time, we made small modifications to their programming to allow them to perform more varied and complex tasks, bringing them closer and closer to true AI status.
Isn't AI research illegal, though?
How come the Council didn't step in and stop you?
This wasn't true AI research. We may have been skirting the bounds of the law, but we never did anything that was actually illegal. The changes were so insignificant, so gradual, that we were able to control them. Or so we thought. But one thing we underestimated was the power of the neural network. A million Geth thinking simultaneously created an inherently unstable matrix.
The neural network?
So, the Geth share brain power?
Many of the Geth's logic systems were designed to work in concert with other nearby Geth. Basically, the more of them you have in the group, the smarter they are.
So it's like a hive mind.
So there's some sort of group consciousness?
No, nothing like that. They cannot share sensory data or information. Their programming cannot handle that much simultaneous input. Each Geth maintains an individual awareness and identity. The neural network only operates on a process-based level. It's basically the synthetic equivalent of a subconscious. But when they're in close proximity, they can coordinate low-level functional processes, freeing up more capacity for original or independent thought.
Yeah, no, still not following.
That doesn't make any sense.
I'm probably oversimplifying. The Geth are incredibly advanced and complex creations. All you need to know is that they get smarter when they gather in large numbers. As we built more and more Geth, their effective intelligence became more sophisticated, more abstract. One day, a Geth began to ask its Quarian overseer questions about the nature of its existence. Am I alive? Why am I here? What is my purpose? As you can imagine, this caused a near panic among my people.
Why?
I don't see what's so bad about those questions.
The Geth were created to engage in mundane, repetitive, or dangerous manual labor. That's fine for machines, but it won't satisfy a sentient being for long.
Okay. Makes sense.
The Geth were showing signs of rudimentary self-awareness and independent thought. If the Geth were intelligent, then we were essentially using them as slaves. It was inevitable the newly sentient Geth would rebel against their situation. We knew they would rise up against us, so we acted first.
Of course.
A general order went out across all Quarian-controlled systems to permanently deactivate all Geth. The Geth responded to this order violently.
Well, it makes sense. They were defending themselves.
You can't blame them for fighting for their survival.
We had no other choice.
Neither did they.
The Geth were already on the verge of revolution. By acting quickly, we had a chance to end the war before it began. The hope was that most of the Geth would still be little more than machines, incapable of organized resistance. But they had progressed much further than anyone anticipated. The war was long and bloody. Millions upon millions of Quarians died at their hands. In the end, we were forced to flee our own homeworld. We feared the Geth would pursue us, but they never came beyond the veil. Now we drift through space, exiled, searching for a way to reclaim what was once ours.
It's almost poetic, but they were defending themselves.
It's hard to feel sorry for you. Your ancestors tried to wipe out another species.
We made a mistake when we created the Geth in the first place, but we did not make a mistake when we went to war against them. If we had not acted, they would have wiped us out. They're a synthetic life form. They have no use for organics. None. Why do you think they cut themselves off from the rest of the galaxy? Why do you think they've killed every organic being who's ever tried to contact them?
Because it's the only thing they've ever known. Anyways, sorry.
I didn't mean to offend you.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to get so worked up. Most Quarians tend to have pretty strong opinions about the Geth.
I can see. What about the pilgrimage?
I want to know more about the pilgrimage.
When my people reach maturity, we leave our birth ships and seek acceptance with a new crew. It's necessary to maintain genetic diversity among the fleet. But no ship wants to accept someone who will be a burden on them. So, to prove our worth, we embark on a pilgrimage. We set out alone, leaving the flotilla and our families behind us. We only return once we have found something of value we can bring back to the fleet. This is presented as a gift to the captain of the respective ship we wish to join. If the gift is accepted, we are welcomed into the crew.
Do they always accept?
Can a captain choose to reject the gift?
That doesn't happen often. Most captains are eager to increase the size of their crew. It increases their own standing in our society. Even when the gift is not particularly valuable, the captain usually accepts it out of a sense of tradition. However, there is a stigma to presenting a substandard gift. It's not the best way to make a good impression on a new community. Most pilgrims don't return until they find something worthwhile.
Sounds dangerous.
I can't believe they just send you off alone.
It's not like they just cast us out. Before we leave, we are given lessons in how to survive outside the flotilla, and given gifts to help us on our journey. We also receive implants to fight off sickness and disease. Generations of living in an isolated and highly controlled environment have left our immune systems weaker than most. By the time we leave the fleet, we are well equipped for the pilgrimage. This is a rite of passage for all Quarians. If it were dangerous, our numbers would suffer. Virtually every pilgrimage ends with a triumphant return and the ritual presentation of the gift to one of the fleet's captains.
Well, pretty much wraps it up for her.
Like what?
Yep.
I should go.
Bye, Tally.
See you later.